Good morning, friends. Welcome to Harpeth Christian Church this morning. I'd like to welcome everybody who's joining us online. It's so great to see all of you. Last weekend, I wasn't here because I had the privilege of getting to spend Father's Day with my 88-year-old father and my 85-year-old mother up in Calgary, Alberta, Canada. And one of the greatest things about coming back is hearing all the good things about JP's teaching at the beginning of Luke chapter 11. And, you know, as a church, we're really committed to Scripture. We're a part of Christian churches because we believe they have the best understanding of Scripture. We're an elder-led church, but we also have a teaching team. And we just believe that being elder-led with a teaching team makes the church much stronger in the long run. And JP will be preaching a lot over the next month or so, and I just appreciate everybody really supporting that and supporting the concept of a teaching team. So, this morning, I am looking at a bunch of people who are biased. Can I just say that? You all are biased. And can I tell you something else? You're looking at me, and I'm biased. Can I tell you the truth? Everyone in here and everyone online, we all have our biases. Can you believe that? We all have a story that we're telling ourselves about reality, about our lives, and about how the way things work. And that story and that bias is a filter that affects everything. Let me give you three examples in the last 24 hours how my biases work. My goodness. So about 24 hours ago, my lovely wife and I had a disagreement. And anybody here who's married who've had a disagreement? Anybody here who's married who had a disagreement in the last 24 hours? Just me, I guess. So we have this disagreement, and my wife was 100% sure she was right. And you know what? I was 100% sure I was right. And that my view was the right view, and she thought her view was the right view. And you know what? It was probably somewhere in between. Let me tell you my second story. So yesterday afternoon, my wife and I took her mother to see the movie Elvis. And I had been looking forward to seeing the movie Elvis just because it's kind of a, you know, cool Americana and the music and all of that. And so I got in there and I'm watching this movie and the movie's going on. At the end afterwards, I'm thinking, is that really the way it was? Is that story the right story? So, of course, I go home and I Google it and, you know, check in all the experts. And one of the guys summarized the movie. He said, it's part fact, part fiction, and it's the screenwriter's story of Elvis. So there was a story that may not be, and in fact, in ways was not, the true story. Are you digging what I'm saying? Let me give you my last example. So I threw off our tech team, Jeff Henkel and Joe and everybody this morning because I slept in. Yeah, the preacher slept in. So here's what happened. I was having a hard time waking up. And I said to my lovely wife, Cindy, who's house up early, I said, honey, would you get me a cup of coffee? Now in my brain, would you get me a cup of coffee meant I'm having a hard time waking up. Could you bring the coffee to me so I can sip it right like here in bed and help me to get up, right? And she is the dearest person on the planet. And she thought, oh, he's getting up. I'll just make the coffee for him. He'll come out into the kitchen and get it. And she went, as she often does in the morning, and went on a long walk. So 45 minutes later, I woke up and I said, where's that coffee? And I went into the kitchen and there it was. She had made it for me. She had a filter, and in my grogginess, I had a filter. Let's pray about what Jesus says about our biases and filters. Kind God, we come to you this morning and we just pray that the words of Jesus, our King and our Savior, through Luke chapter 11, would be embedded in our hearts to change our lives, to honor and love you better, God. In Jesus' name, amen. If you have a Bible, open it up, if you would, to Luke chapter 11. And we're going to see a scene where Jesus is going to be locked in conversations with people who don't believe what Jesus teaches. And the first scene that's going to happen, let me read it to you, is in verse 14. And it says, Jesus was driving out a demon that was mute. So there's a person who has a demon, and the demon makes it so the person couldn't speak. Jesus was driving out a demon that was mute. When the demon left, the man who had been mute spoke, and the crowd was amazed. Now, what are they going to do about this demon? So if it was you and me, and it was a, you know, if this happened today here in 2022, and all of a sudden somebody was mute, and then this teacher, this prophet came and claimed to cast out a demon, and this person talked, our natural default wouldn't have been he cast out the demon. It would be, was there mental illness? What kind of mental illness was this? And what kind of psychological thing did he do? What kind of form of hypnosis? We would think totally secularly through like a human lens on it, right? Now, in the ancient world, that wasn't the way they thought. In the ancient world, they automatically thought about God and spiritual powers. So right away, they know this was a demon, and this Jesus guy casts out the demon. But now they have a problem because they have their filters. They're telling themselves stories about Jesus, and the story they're telling themselves is he's not the Son of God. He's not a true prophet. So what happens is they watch what Jesus did, and here's how they respond in verse 15. Some of them said, by Beelzebub, the prince of demons, he's driving out demons. Others tested him by asking for a sign from heaven. So some people look at that and they say, okay, this is a real demonic encounter, but you're not from God because you can't be from God. We don't think you're from God. So when you cast out a demon, it had to have been like a demon was working in you to cast the demon out of that guy. And other people say, wow, he cast out a demon, but he can't be who he says he is. We need to see a sign. Like, we're not going to believe you unless you give us a sign. Now, to both of those things, Jesus is saying, not going to do that. Now, before I get into what Jesus said, I just want to ask you to think about yourselves. Like, go back in time as though you were there. What would you do? What filters do you have like I have? And what story are we telling us about these things? So Jesus, right away, he confronts them and he says, look, what you're saying doesn't make sense. A house divided against itself can't stand, which, by the way, Abraham Lincoln also quoted a long time ago. Good quote, by the way. If we are not united, we can't stand. But back to the text. Jesus says this, look, if Satan is casting out Satan, that's like stupid because that's weakening Satan. Why would Satan, who already possesses somebody, cast out Satan and the demon? Why would the demon cast out a demon? Makes no sense, right? And the second thing, he doesn't even answer. Because you don't get to test God. It's like, we can't say to God, I won't believe in you unless you prove it to me. Because God has embedded the universe. He's embedded the consciousness that you have and I have, that actually in our heart of hearts, we are aware that God is there. He doesn't have to prove himself to us. We just have to admit that we're aware and work through the filters that cause us not to admit that God is there. So as Jesus walks through the story, he's just trying to help them to see the way you're thinking isn't right. The story you're telling yourself isn't right. The biases that you have, they don't work. Okay, how about bias number three? Bias number three, they're looking at this, Jesus is saying these things, and a woman is there in the crowd, and she calls out. Now, in Judaism in the first century, if you had a good man, guess who they attributed that you had a good man to? Yes, they said it was his mother. And so one of the ideals of a godly woman in Judaism is to raise up children who were godly people. By the way, I think that still applies, right? That's like a big part of Scripture as we went through Old Testament, New Testament would be, you know, really disciple your children so that they grow up to be godly people. So that's a good thing. So this woman says to Jesus, she's got a filter. And her filter is, Jesus, you're a great prophet, so blessed is the mother who gave you birth and who nursed you. Now, Jesus is not saying she's totally off her rocker, but he says, you're telling yourself a story and you're missing the bigger story. The bigger story is, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and obey it. Blessed woman would be you if you focus on hearing the word of God yourself and obeying it. So, as we work through this, all of a sudden, Jesus is having all these incidents throughout Luke 11 of how people look at things and how it's actually not the right way to look at things and how they look at things a certain way and it totally skews them so that they cannot understand who Jesus is and they can't trust and follow him because they're biases. It's religious biases, it's cultural narratives, it's family stories, it's the things that they believe that are actually biases and filters that stop them from really hearing what Jesus is saying. And then he slows down and he wants to make sure they understand. So he says this, no one lights a lamp and puts it in a place where it will be hidden. You gotta remember, in the ancient world, no electricity. You light lamps, you have a lamp in the room, the lamp lights up everything. So you wouldn't put it where it would be hidden or under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand so that those who come in may see the light. Imagine if all of a sudden the lights went out in here. Now, what can you see that's in this room? And then if the lights come back on, now look and see what you can see. So there's a light in the room, and by the light in the room, we can see what we couldn't see before. And Jesus is saying, there is a light. It's the light of truth. It's the light of God's truth that if you let it in, it's like a lamp in a dark room. He goes on and says, your eye is the lamp of your body. Now here the eye is a metaphor. He doesn't literally mean, you know, your eye that lets in light, although metaphorically that does happen. He's saying your spiritual eye, he's saying the way you listen, the way you look at things, your truth detector, the filter that you have, the commitment that you have to see things rightly and accurately, the humility that you have to realize that the things you're telling yourself, the things that you're thinking, the biases that you have may not be the right ones. And so your eye, your spiritual eye, is the lamp of the body. When your eyes are healthy, your whole body is also full of light. But when they are unhealthy, your whole body is full of darkness. Jesus says you can think things and you can have narratives, you can have stories that hurt you. They're dark, they're darkness that you've embraced and accepted. That's why he always says, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Ask, seek, knock. He who seeks will find. He who knocks will find the door is opened. Work hard, he says, to see God's truth and to live in the light of God's truth. See to it then that the light within you is not darkness. Let's just declare it. There's darkness all around us. We're talking about spiritual darkness. We're talking about the filters that prohibit us from seeing the truth. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4 says, for the whole non-believing world, there is a veil that covers their eyes from the demonic forces of Satan. That literally we come into the world, and we come into the world, we're born into the world, and there is a darkness that only the teachings of Jesus, empowered by the Holy Spirit, can remove the scales so that we can see the light and see the truth, so that we can see true truth. The most unbiased person is the person who says, I have biases, and are my biases right? I have a story, and is my story the right story? I have a narrative, is it the right narrative? Is what I'm telling myself the real, true reality? Therefore, if your whole body is full of light and no part of it dark, it will be just as full of light as when a lamp shines its light on you. How are we doing? How are we doing? Can I tell you something? Yesterday, Cindy and I are having this argument, and it's just like our fleshly ways. What can I say? But we have a great marriage, everybody. We do, we really do. But in it, we can still have these moments. And I'm just saying that so everybody knows that's reality for most couples. And still, God works in it. It's a good thing. But halfway through the argument, I was thinking, because I'm totally right. You know that, right? Like, I am right. And halfway through it, I realized, wait, she's right about that, and I'm wrong. Now, let me ask you this. Anybody who's ever had an argument with somebody? When you realize all of a sudden they got a good point and they're right and I'm wrong, what's the natural tendency? I'm not going to admit that. Well, it's true of everything, isn't it? Now, I'd like to do the best I can right now to give a macro picture on spiritual reality in which we live, which you live, because we live here in Middle Tennessee in the United States in 2022. So we live in a time of great change religiously and culturally and every other way. And here we are in Middle Tennessee, and probably 80% of people will claim to be Christians, right? And so sometimes it gets real confusing because you have all these people who claim to be Christians, and they claim that what they're saying is right, and you have all these denominations and all these organizations, and it can get really confusing. And that's the truth of the matter. So if like 80% around us are claiming to be Christians and you and I are interacting with that, What's the filter that we should use when it comes to this thing about light? Well, I wanted to share with you something that as a team, our leadership team was talking about as a really important filter. And it's a real simple way to look at it from 1 John chapter 1. Here's what God inspires John to say. If we claim to have fellowship with him, that would be God through Jesus, and yet we walk in darkness, we lie and do not live by the truth. Okay, John? How do we know that we, when we say we're a Christian, we really are? Well, don't be walking in darkness. What's walking in darkness? In the Greek text goes back to the Hebrew, which is a walk is the basic direction of your life. So for somebody who's a genuine follower of Jesus, they're going to wake up every morning. They have the Holy Spirit living within. So they're aware of God. They're aware of the things of God. In various fashions, they're going to walk with God throughout the day. They're going to live a life where we love God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and we love our neighbor as ourselves. That'll be the dominant operating system. Does that make sense? It's not like every once in a while I'm religious or when I go to bed, I just say, no, we're walking with God every day. But a lot of people claim to have a relationship, yet they walk in darkness. He says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. So we're going to walk in the life of Jesus, light of Jesus. The basic direction of our life is going to be that we're walking. We have a faith that is a faithful faith according to Scripture. But if we walk in the light as he's in the light, we have fellowship with one another. So we're going to be committed in the local church. We have to have, like, part of walking in the light is being committed to a local church with fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. And he goes on and he says, if we claim we've not sinned, we're liars, because everybody is going to stumble and fall at some point. So let me share an example, a Middle Tennessee example. And it's because I love you and I love God's truth that I'm sharing this story. So I've been working with Anthony Walker, who's the senior minister of a church, an African-American church in Murfreesboro. For the last year, we've been working on this project, trying to pursue what harmony would be between races and between everybody based on Scripture. And so as we've been doing that, we've become very close friends. And there's a lady, I'm going to just call her Becky. It's not her real name, but her name, I'm going to call her Becky. She's been involved with us in these conversations regularly. And this past week, she asked us, she said, would you guys pray for me for my anxiety? And she said, how do you guys deal with anxiety? And, you know, we just talked about how anxiety can be it's actually a bigger part of people's lives this time in history than before. So a lot of people struggle with anxiety. We started talking about it. And then Anthony pressed her a little bit. And because as she shared her life with us, it wasn't the right time to talk to her, but there's a key area where she's walking in darkness. She claims to be a Christian, but she's literally walking in darkness. And so he pressed her on it, and she was asking, and then, you know, being the timid and non-forthright person that I am, I'm the opposite of that, unfortunately, sometimes. I had to speak up and say, Becky, you know you're not living right. She goes, what? Becky, you've told us of your relationship with this person that's been going on for 3.5 years. And she's, what? Like, oh, it's not a platonic relationship. The Bible says that's sexual immorality. And she goes, what? Oh, my friends, we all go to church and we all do it. Well, this is not an area where the Bible has ambiguity. It's like, it's sexual immorality. What? She said, I even talked to my dad, and he's a church-going man, and he said how times change and it's okay. And I go, Becky, do you want to see what the Bible says on that? Because, like, the Bible's kind of black and white about this point. She goes, yeah, show it to me. So I showed it to her. And then here's what happened. I mean, you know, not too long ago, this has been like really clear for anybody who claims to be a Christian. But then I realized she's going to be thinking all kinds of things. And I put my arm around her and I just said, I just want to help you to walk in the light and truth of Jesus. We're living in a time where people are remaking what it really means to be a Christian. Let me give you another example. Actually, you know, if you go down to verse 37 through the end of the chapter, Jesus is going to interact with the religious leaders about a bunch of ways. Like he's going to say, you care about external rituals, God cares about what's going on in the heart. You care about being religious, God cares that you take care of the poor and that you're merciful to the downtrodden. So let me tie in something here. That everybody's got biases. And on Friday, the Supreme Court invalidated Roe versus Wade, which means that let me explain why that's a good thing and why I just thank God for it. By the way, this is not a political issue. I know that it's really easy to think that this is a talking point of people who are Republicans. I just want to say the Republicans have their story of reality, the Democrats have their story of reality, and neither of those stories are real reality. The real story of reality is King Jesus is Lord of Lords and King of Kings. He has a kingdom, and his political kingdom is the most important kingdom, and it will triumph over Democrats, Republicans, socialists, libertarians, whoever it is. Our loyalty is King Jesus, first of all, okay? And King Jesus really teaches us that life begins at conception in the womb. Psalm 139, David says, God, you knit me together in my mother's womb. And so those of us who care about the teaching of God would really thank God, because it'll be 12 to 15% less unborn human beings put to death. And I thank God for that, and I thank and encourage everybody who's worked to protect these unborn human beings. Let me also say that in your typical audience, a third of the men and women would have been involved in abortion. And by the way, that includes, and in some ways, men, we could argue, are even more responsible for shirking responsibility and not stepping up and all of that. But I just want to say that God forgives all sins of those who are truly repentant. but I'm so grateful. And as a church, let's rally around adoption. Let's provide so that every woman, every young lady who gets pregnant doesn't despair and feel like they've got to get an abortion, because they know churches and Christians who will help them bring that child to life and help them take care of that child or help them adopt that child, so that no child ever needs to lose its life in the womb. And then lastly, I just say this, with trying to have as best I can the eyes of Jesus and the eyes of Scripture, that in this cultural chaos and this conflict that is only increasing more and more, that we are going to have people we disagree with. There will be people who disagree with me. In fact, I had somebody at the end of the first service saying, I'm not sure what you were saying about that. And all I can say is I'm trying to look at it through the eyes of Jesus. But somebody who doesn't agree with me, they are not my enemy. And I'm called by God to love everyone and to see somebody who doesn't see the truth of Jesus here, not as my enemy, but somebody who's been captured by our real enemy, Satan. And Satan is leading them to think things that aren't true about life, that we would be kind and loving. Now, if you'd like to learn more about this, I have two things I want to recommend to you. Actually, can I just tell you a little bit? I became a follower of Jesus as a university student. And before that, I'm just going to be really transparent with everybody. I was actually in favor of abortion. I can remember thinking, if my girlfriend's pregnant, I can remember thinking, oh, it'll wreck her life, wreck mine. And I remember thinking, oh, these voices over here, la, 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 that should be fine. And I was all for it. Because when you have a view of reality that doesn't start, have as its undergirding and its ultimate goal the things of God, you're going to have views of life that my happiness, my individual happiness, my pursuit of the best human experience I individually can have, that'll be your God. And when that's your God, you're going to have everything work around that. But what happened to me is I came to see I'm not God. There is a God. I'm accountable to him. I've fallen short of his glory. I need to repent and turn to him and place him at the throne of my life. And now that he's at the throne of my life, whatever he says about every issue, I want to surrender to King Jesus and follow King Jesus. And so I have tried to speak to you about the teaching of King Jesus. Now, I want to show you, if you'd like, take a picture of this. If you're here and you're saying, I don't know about what you're saying, Bobby, I'd like you to consider reading that and the resources there. Or better yet, at 4:00 this afternoon, Carol Swain will be with us. She's actually the ideal person to speak on the issues because she's going to talk about abortion, but she talks as somebody who had an abortion. She's going to talk about the sanctity of marriage as somebody who, before she came to know Jesus, lost her way in marriage. She's going to talk about race as a woman who really experienced persecution as an African American. And she's going to talk about gender as somebody who understands the importance of not being misogynists, but who sees what Scripture says about male leadership and headship in the home and in the local church. And she can talk about greed because she has a story of being a tenured professor at Princeton who was sold out to greed. So I just want to encourage you to come back at 4:00 if you would like to know anything about these conversations. Now, this is where I get to do 5 extra minutes in the second service. Yeah, which it's so great what we do with the kids in the first, but I like the opportunity to do a little deeper dive. So I'd like to talk to you right now about this cultural context that we live in and truth. And here's what I mean by that. There's a lot of things that are being brought to our attention these days about microaggressions. So let me talk to you a little bit about that. A microaggression is where you might have attitudes or biases that make other people uncomfortable. So for example, an African-American person is going to be very uncomfortable about anybody who has any explicit racism or latent racism. And people who have racist assumptions can easily commit microaggressions. In other words, you can put people in a box, you can assume things about people that are hurtful to that person. Is everybody with me? We've got to see the merit of some of this. Now, it goes too far, but we can't understand how it goes too far if we don't understand the valid point being made. Can I get some amens about that? So let me talk about another area, would be gender. There's a lot of people who have had biased ideas that about women and about how women should be treated and about what women can do in the world or not do. And those biases can be hurtful to women. In fact, most women have lived their lives just being aware of the biases and working through those biases. Is everybody good with that so far? Say amen if you are. Stay with me on this, friends, because in this cultural moment, we've got to be really clear thinking. Now, in the midst of all of that, there are ungodly perspectives that are being foisted upon, especially through social media, through corporations, through universities. It's really the air we breathe now. And I won't take time to go and identify all those, but they're ungodly ideas that are contrary to Scripture. For people like me and you who follow Scripture, we are considered to be haters who regularly indulge in microaggressions. And therefore, our voices need to be canceled. So what are we going to do about that? Well, the first thing we always want to do is see the truth, speak the truth with love, and uphold the way of God. But all of us, we're going to be surrounded by people who think that we as followers of Jesus are committing microaggressions regularly. I'm an old white Christian man. So automatically, people have biases about me. I'm a biased person. I'm a hater because of what I believe about Jesus. Now, how am I going to handle that? Am I going to hate everybody back? Or am I going to learn to handle it differently? So here's three things about that I want to encourage us all. First off, let's always be thoughtful and compassionate about everybody's background. I just want to say it again. Somebody who differs with me is not my enemy, even though they can feel like your enemies. But they're people for whom Jesus died. Secondly, my default response is not to hate back, as I've said, but to be forgiving and gracious for where they're coming from, even as I speak the truth. And then thirdly, this is so important. We've got to relearn to be tough-minded. Even when people cancel me, like I'm suppressed, I'm shadow banned on Facebook. I'm shadow banned on Twitter because I am loudly proclaiming the name of Jesus. And are people persecuting me? Do I have non-Christian friends who used to be Christians who now say bad things about me? Yes. Do I have people who think I'm a hater? Yes. Do I have all of that? Yes. But what is my response? My response is to be a tough-minded and say, I follow Jesus, I will be forgiving and gracious, and I am responsible for doing the right thing regardless of any microaggression. Regardless of the snide comments, regardless of the bad things, regardless of where I'm excluded, regardless of what people think, I am going to be mentally tough and say, Jesus is right, and I'm going to speak Jesus' truth into my mind all the time about everything. Life is tough, friends. Life, God is good and God is with us, but life is tough. Life is not fair. We are going to experience things we never wanted, but guess what? We can make it. Jesus said, in this world you have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. So always we want to be tough-minded and truthful with Jesus' truth. Love God, love people, be kind and gracious, and be tough-minded. I will do the right thing regardless of how I am treated, regardless of how I'm understood, regardless of how I'm spoken about, regardless of what they say, think, or do about me, I will seek to be the light of Jesus. And I will speak out and say, abortion is the taking of an unborn human being. I will say, God intends us to stay married. I will say that God wants us as people to uphold that in the home, he calls men to to be the Christ-like heads of their home, and that's not misogyny. And in the church, male leadership in terms of speaking, preaching, and eldership, it's not misogyny, it's a better way, it's the created order that actually brings out the best in men and women long term. And I will speak all of these things with a tough-mindedness. Can you hear me? When the Bible says we must love God with all of our heart, all of our mind, we have to think well to honor God. So I hope that encourages you. I mean it too, because I love you, and I want us as the family of God's people to really pursue his ways. I want to ask you to look at this picture. This is a picture of a swimmer. I didn't actually know that this could happen. It's the American swimmer who's over in Europe, and she was swimming, and they say that swimmers literally push themselves as far as they can be pushed. I know Doug Robertson and Lily and others would tell us this is true. Well, she fainted. She was swimming underwater, and she fainted. Now, here's what happened. There were a bunch of people who were looking on when she fainted, and they were looking on like, what's happening, and what do we do, and all of that. And the head coach, who was way far off, her last name is Fuentes, she saw what was happening, and she realized all those people looking, they don't realize what's happened. And she said she ran as fast as she could. She herself is an Olympic medalist. She said, I have never run and swam as fast as I did. She dove in, and she was able to get to her in time and get her back up and save her life. Now, here's why. She knew the truth, even though everybody didn't around. She not only knew the truth, she knew what had to be done, how urgent it was, and she got right after it. I'd like you to see this as an analogy for what Jesus is teaching us this morning about the light. See, there are a bunch of people, and they're dying all around us. They are. Like, spiritually, they've fainted. They don't get it. They don't understand. And a bunch of people are looking in that they don't understand. But Jesus wants you and me to understand. And not just understand, but to act on it. And not just for ourselves, but for all these people who are around us. That we would know what's going on. We would know the peril. We would see the light. We would act on the light. And we would do what needs to be done. Do you want to be that kind of person? I hope every one of us wants to be that kind of person. Can you all stand? But here's where it begins. I actually just want to go where the sermon began. I just want you all to know you're biased. And I'm biased. And the most unbiased person is the person who knows their bias. If you've never done it, I want to encourage you to ask yourself if Jesus really is the Son of God and the Savior and the saving King of humanity. A bunch of people have biases where they can't think that. I want to ask you to look at, is that right? Seek, knock, ask. But then in our lives, once we've said, I'm going to believe in Jesus, I want us to be people who believe in Jesus. Now, forget what I want. God wants you to be somebody who pursues the light so that you can walk in the light and live in the light and honor God so that when Jesus comes back, we're a people prepared for him, waiting for him. So I just want to ask this morning, we're going to take just a minute here, and if anybody has anything that you want to make right with God, where you just want to bow your knee, I'm going to do it. And I'm just going to say, God, just help me to be open to any area where I have darkness and I don't see the light. Open my eyes to see the light, Lord, that the light within me would fill me so that I would walk in the light. If you have anything like that, I would encourage you to come to the altar with me as we just take this moment and pause, and then the praise team will lead us in a song.